Hey, what's up, Blender users? I'm Jonathan, and in the next two videos, after I briefly showed you how to create granular simulations with Storm last week, I want to give you a more fleshed out example on how to utilize granular simulations. So let's get started and create this dirt explosion from scratch. Oh, and by the way, if you enjoy my content, consider subscribing because I upload a new video every Saturday. In today's video, we'll focus on tracking our footage, setting up the scene and creating a basic hole in the ground. In next week's video, we'll then add the granular simulation, shade and composite it. So, with your footage ready, we first want to convert it into an image sequence. This will help later because we won't have to worry about our frame rate. So let's switch over to Video Sequencer and change our type to Sequencer/Preview. We can then just drag and drop our movie clip into the editor timeline. You can see that two clips have been generated. The bottom one is just for audio, so we can delete it with X. Now you can set your start and end frame to wherever you like it, but personally I'm just gonna leave it but change the end frame to 100. Now we want to make sure that our frame rate is correct for this time only, but this should all be set correctly once you've imported your video. Also, you can change your resolution. This video was filmed in 4K, so I will also export in 4K just so we get the most amount of detail. You can also decide which file format you want to use for your image sequence. I would recommend PNG because the compression of JPEG images really shows if you want to track small details. For this video, we of course don't need RGBA, only red, green and blue. And compression can be left at 15% or even lower at 0. This is up to you. The file size will drastically increase when lowering the compression rate. Now the last thing to do is to set the view transform to standard because having it on Filmic will affect the colors. And now you can just set an output path and render your sequence with Ctrl and F12. I now have all my images ready so we can proceed to track our scene. So let's click on this plus icon right here and add the motion tracking workspace. And we can just go ahead and open our images. Make sure that you're sorting it with descending names because other sort options, for example sorting it after the date, will mess up the importer. And now with A, select everything and click on open clip. Great, we can now set scene frames and prefetch our clip, which will take a few seconds because this clip is 4K. And now everything has been loaded and we can proceed with tracking our scene. For a scene like this, where we have lots of small details, I always like to use the detect features option. But you can see that once I click on it, nothing really happens. To actually get tracking markers in our scene, I have to reduce the threshold as well as the distance between tracking markers. I now want to scale them up and with Ctrl and T, we can track them forward. I now have enough tracking markers on the sides, but not enough in the middle where I actually want the dirt explosion to be. So we'll have to use detect features again, but there's actually a small little trick that we can now use to make our job a little bit easier. And this is that we can press and hold D and draw around this area right here. And now let's click on the detect features. And when we select inside annotated area, only tracking markers in this area will appear, which we can now scale up and track backwards with Ctrl+Shift+T. Alright, everything has been tracked now, but you can see that on the last frame our annotation is still visible. We can delete it in the annotation tab right here. Let's try solving for the camera motion. If you know your focal length or sensor width, you can input them in the track panel right here under camera settings. Personally, I don't know these settings, so I'll try to solve for focal length. And you can see that we get a solve error below 1, which is great, so this is basically usable. And we can already try it out. Just select everything with A, delete it, click on set as background and set up tracking scene. And you can see that in wireframe mode, which we can enter with Z, that all of the tracking markers stick pretty well to the ground. Awesome. Let's now use the orientation panel right here to orientate our scene correctly. I'll just choose this marker right here as the origin and these two markers who roughly have a distance of 1 meter between them to set the scale of our scene. We can now delete the cube because it isn't needed right now and we can also scale down the ground plane. If we enter this window and press Ctrl and spacebar, we can go into full screen and you can see that the floor orientation is correct. We do not need to change anything here. If this isn't correct for you, you just have to select three markers on the ground and click on floor. Sometimes you'll have to repeat this a few times with different markers to get the best result. Great, let's now switch to the basic layout workspace and create the hole in the ground. But first of all, let's enable the tracking markers. For this, we want to enter this viewport overlays menu and enable motion tracking. And there we have our tracking markers in the scene. But you can now see that it isn't aligned to the world floors, so it seems like we have to set our floor plane. So let's just go with these three markers and click on floor. You can see that this looks a little bit off. So let's go with these three markers and I think this looks good. Now we'll have to set the origin again. But now you can see that everything is correctly aligned to the world floor. For now, we can disable this plane and now worry about the hole in the ground. To create the mesh for the hole, I'm using the ANT Landscape add-on, which comes shipped with Blender, so you can just search for it and enable it. So let's go ahead and choose Landscape. And now let's adjust the falloff to 1.5, so we get just the tip of a mountain right here, and we can also adjust the offset as well as the height. Now to make a proper hole, we of course have to rotate it 180 degrees on either the X and Y axis. So let's do this and you can now see that we get a pretty big hole in our scene. Of course this is way too big, so let's scale it down to maybe this size right here. Now let's create a material for this hole. For this I'll first switch over to Cycles and now go into rendered mode. For now I will disable scene world so we get a basic HDRI. And now open the shader editor. With the object selected, we can press on new to get a new material and add in an image texture. I'll use the first image of our image sequence for texturing purposes. Right now you can't see anything because this hasn't been unwrapped. So let's go into edit mode, select everything and press U, project from view. And now you can see that we have projected our dirt texture from the first image onto our mesh. And this already looks good. If it doesn't for you, you can always change the location of your texture with a mapping node. Okay, great, let's hook this image up to the base color and preview it with our principal BSDF. And once we enable transparent under film, you can see that this fits in quite well. But of course, there's a major problem, and this is that we first of all see harsh edges and at the bottom of our hole. This is of course not really realistic, so let's fix it. We'll first worry about the hard edges. And for this, we'll add in a gradient texture node and change it to quadratic sphere. And now let's use the object coordinates. And just like this, we can plug the color output into the alpha channel input of the principal BSDF shader. And now you can see that we now have a nice smooth falloff for the edges, but overall it's a lot too transparent. So let's add in a color ramp and position the white handle more to the left. And just like this, we have a nice smooth falloff and a good transparency value. But the problem still remains that we see the bottom. We can fix it by using a geometry node and the back-facing value. You can see that only the faces that face up are being highlighted. And now let's add in a holdout shader as well as a mix shader and mix both the holdout and the principal BSDF together with the back-facing output as the factor. And now you can see none of the back-facing faces are being rendered. Awesome, and just like this, we have our hole. To finish up this first part, I quickly want to make a test render. So let's up the tiles because I'm rendering on a GPU. And with F12, we can render out our scene. And once the render is finished, you can see that we can't see anything. This is because for now, the ground plane in the background has been disabled. But once we enable it, you can see that it cuts off our hole. This is because the background collection is set to holdout, so everything that is below this plane will not be rendered. We can fix this by disabling the background collection from view layer. And when we now render it, you can see that our hole is being rendered. Of course, right now, the hole is way too dark because we don't have an HDRI, but we'll add an HDRI in the next video. Just a quick tip to finish up this video. If you want transparency to render faster, you can enable adaptive sampling. If we now render our scene, you can see that it takes 10 seconds less to render it out. Awesome! And this finishes up our first part, and we'll see each other in the next video next Saturday, where I'll show you how to add a granular simulation to this scene.